and welcome to another exciting edition of Sports Wrap. I am Frank Walsh, along with the usual suspects, Michael Wigdor, and our smart aleck PhD know-it-all, TJ Chamberlain.
Yeah.
You know, we always tell you when the show starts, to, you know, TJ, not to embarrass the host.
The host.
Because we have a lot of stuff to talk about today. We're going to be talking a little bit about the Red Sox. We're going to be talking, you know, maybe a little bit about the Patriots. Who knows what else time is left, but we have to kick it off with our own wearers of green, the Boston Celtics.
Yeah,
they are standing right now 2-0, looking good going forward. So one of you guys take the ball and run with it.
Oh, boy.
Take it, Mikey. You're the basketball guy.
I am. I'm really happy about this. You know, the Celtics... To me, they look like a totally determined team this year, whereas when they played the San Francisco Warriors, it was like, well, we hope we can win, you know. But their effort wasn't there, and I don't think the effort was there, but mentally they weren't ready. And now they are ready, they can taste it, and you could see that there's no let up, they're not shooting great, Tatum is not shooting the ball very well. But their defense is fantastic, and there's guys that are stepping up that nobody thought would be stepping up as much in this series. Kristaps Porzingis is doing. He was basically the reason they won Game One. He had a fantastic game. I think he scored like 20-something points, but like most of them in the first half, and actually most of them almost in the first quarter. It was just an amazing performance because the guy had not played for like, you know, weeks and months, really.
Coming off the bench, too.
Coming off the bench, that's right. And the other major factor, I would say, was Game Two, was Jrue Holiday. What a massive game. I mean, great shooting. He was 11 of 14, I looked it up. And great defense, rebounds. He was definitely the reason that they won Game Two, because that was, like people were saying, a rock fight. And they ended up winning it in usual Celtics fashion at the end of the game, playing great defense. So I think going into Game Three, before we go to the next guy here, TJ, our professor TJ, I think the Celtics, you know, people say, well, Dallas has the edge now, they're home, but the Celtics are 6-0 on the road, and I still think Celtics will find a way to win the next game too. So I look for them to be 3-0 after Wednesday night.
All right, so now it's on to me. So the Celtics, yes, they have been performing extremely well, and there are people at first, they're like, oh, but to get in, they had to beat a Miami team without Jimmy Butler, beat Cleveland with the last game of that series, actually the last two games, they were without Donovan Mitchell, then Indiana without Halliburton, and I mean, they swept them, so I'm thinking, oh, Dallas is going to be a little bit more of a challenge. They of course, have Luka, they got Kyrie, Washington and Gafford, those were big additions for them at the trade deadline, turned their defense from, I think it was 23rd to 6th before the end of the regular season, and they had to go through a gauntlet to get into the finals. They had to beat the Clippers, then they beat the Thunder, that was the one seed in the West, and then Minnesota, who beat the defending champions in Denver before going to the Western Conference Finals and losing to Dallas. So Dallas, they had to go through a gauntlet, and I think they used a lot of their energy into those three series. Game two was close, but game one, once they were down early, it's like they kind of just dug that hole. Of course, Porzingis, we mentioned game one. Big game one. And also another thing that, to this day, still kind of crazy to think about. The Celtics really got Porzingis and two firsts for trading Marcus Smart. They got first in return in that deal. And Jrue Holiday, they got after, because Holiday originally was in the Damian Lillard deal,
right.
That Holiday was in Portland for a little bit, and then he got traded for, it was Brogdon and Robert Williams, also a couple picks, which, shocker. Brogdon and Williams both got injured. Because it's not like that has happened many times before, and another thing that Mike was mentioning earlier, that 2022 against Golden State, not San Francisco. They haven't been called the San Francisco Warriors
oh, you're right.
in over half a decade. And also like, oh, Tatum's not shooting well. He's shooting 12 for 38 the first two games of the series. However, he's averaging 17 and 8.5. So
plus even, he got 12 assists the other night.
Yeah, that's why he's averaging 8.5 assists, because he had 5 assists in game 1.
Yeah, so he's doing what he can to help the team win the game.
Game 3 is...
But can I just say one thing before you go on?
Yeah.
Okay, so Dallas went through a gauntlet, but now they're playing the second strongest defensive team in the league, in the Celtics. And the Celtics, you know, you're right, they went through the, but the Celtics are 14-2 coming into play. You know, they maybe it would have been closer, but I think the Celtics would have won those series too. But I agree with you, you could be right. Because Kyrie definitely does not seem like he's capable of making those kind of, you know, great shots and winning and helping them win. Luka's going crazy.
Plus, you have to look at it too, that the Celtics have so much depth. I mean, you know, that's the thing that's, you know, was killing them and all the other teams, is that, you know, the other team, you know, they bring in even, you know, what's his name? Porzingis, when he came off the bench. They had no one to go up against him. You know, they cannot match him on the bench. Their depth is so good, and that anybody who steps on the court seems to be just too good for whoever's out there on defense. And also, let's not forget, you know, I'd like your opinion on this, is that we're talking about the players all the time. What's your take on the coaching, the way this team has been prepared and the way the team has been coached? Because I think that is a big factor in how they're doing.
Well, now that Mazzulla, he actually got a full season under his staff, because last season he still had Adoka's staff, because we didn't think that Mazzulla was going to be the head coach going into the season. We're thinking, oh, the Celtics just made the finals. Adoka had a really good season. The Celtics can build on that. And then all the allegations came out. And then, nope, you're out of here. Mazzulla just, it's placed in. I mean, first he was growing pains, which Mazzulla, he still has some of those, but for the most part, regular season was really good, but also that part of it's what happens when you have guys like Tatum, Brown, Derek White, Porzingis, Drew Holiday, Al Horford off the bench, Peyton Pritchard, Luke Kornet was solid off the bench during the regular season.
Sam Hauser.
Yep. That's for those who are keeping track at home.
But you look at that though, in that these were games that, you know, earlier in the year, the Celtics would have leads. They would play these games, and then they'd get that lapse. You know, they showed a little bit in, you know, one of the first game where they had the lapse in the third quarter. It was the first game, the second game.
It was the first game.
Yeah, they had the lapse in the third quarter.
Also in season tournament.
And then, you know, the game that they, you know, the one was a really close game. But, you know, I think that, you know, I think that Mazzulla has really put, like, you know, like, listen, guys, you can't lay down. You can't sit on the lead. Yeah. You know, go for the juggler. Go for the throat. And I think that they stepped up in the situation where, in the past, they might have done stupid things. Yeah, because they, you know.
Oh, I think they're way beyond that.
They start throwing up bad shots. They don't move the ball around. And then I don't see them doing that anymore. And I think that they are hell-bent for leather that they're going to, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if they take them in 4.
I wouldn't either.
I really wouldn't be surprised.
Yeah,
I don't think they will, but I wouldn't be surprised.
I wouldn't be surprised either, because Kyrie Irving, unless he starts picking it up, they said he was 0 for 8 in threes, and he's only shooting at 35%.
Well, he's statistically
bad at
all.
A lot of that to the defense, though. I mean, the defense, especially on their big gun there, you know, they're holding him down.
Well, Jaylen Brown, Derek White, Drew Holiday, they're all like top defensive players.
They're swarming them, They're not giving them chances.
Dallas hasn't played a team like the Celtics. They have like 4 or 5 almost all-star players, and they just have so much more than Dallas. Like, if Luka and Kyrie don't score at a high level, the game is not going to be that competitive.
Exactly. And I think that Holiday, I think you nailed the head, you know, that, you know, Holiday right now is just, he's the MVP, the experience with him. I think he's able to settle them down a little bit.
He said that.
You know, he settles them down. He keeps them in the game.
Yep.
He doesn't let them get complacent.
Yep.
And he has the capability to step up when he needs to. You know, there are other teams that when, you know, like, you know, Tatum or Brown, they're not scoring, he can step right in there and give you 20, 25 points.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, he's got a ton of playoff experience, too.
Yeah, he can bring that stability and experience with him.
Yeah, it's a bunch of different teams, too, because I think the first time off the top of my head that I know Holiday was in the playoffs, it was This is how long he's been in the league. 2012, when he was with Philadelphia. Then he spent a number of years with New Orleans when they had Anthony Davis there. He was the second guy with Anthony Davis. And also there was 1 year with Boogie Cousins as well, even though I think this was the season that he tore his Achilles. This was 2018. And then he was on the Milwaukee championship team in 2021.
That's right.
And that brings a lot to the table. Plus, yes, you know, he's very cool. I mean, I normally don't listen to the interviews, yeah, but I listen to him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He is very well spoken.
He is.
He's, you know, he doesn't shoot from the hip. He's very factual.
Yeah.
You know, he's very honest. And, you know, even that little gaffe when he fell for the, you know, who's better, Tatum or Brown, you know, he fell into that a little, but we came right back the next day and he said, hey, listen, I need to, you know, amplify what I had said yesterday. Yeah. And he straightened out the sheets a little bit about that comment that he made about
I love what Tatum said,
and
too.
Brown.
Yeah. Post-game. And Al Horford said it as well. He's like, yeah, I'm not falling for that.
Exactly.
That's what Jason Kidd would say before game two.
Yeah. Yeah.
Saying that Brown's the MVP.
And I love what Tatum said in post-game, too, because he was saying, well, I don't care if I don't make shots. He goes, it's not my ego. I don't need
exactly.
to. I'll do whatever it takes to win. That is like 100% different than what Tatum had said.
That's unlike him to say that.
No, he never would have said that.
And I think Holiday is one of the contributors to that.
I think so, too.
Because, it takes the pressure off of him and Brown. You know,
that's
Tatum
right.
and Brown, it takes the pressure off them because if they know that they're not getting the shots, they can make that extra pass, give him the open shots, and let them take care of defense and let them, you know, be the playmakers.
Well, Porzingis, too, is a big key,
Porzingis
too.
They
need to have him, I think, especially back in Dallas.
You have nobody to match up against him. You know,
they don't have anybody to match up.
Pretty much got the rule of the court.
As long as he's healthy and can run, and hopefully he will be able. Yeah. He said he would.
Didn't he tweak his calf again, though, the other night?
He tweaked it, but it's not major. Also, another thing that's actually kind of interesting, too, is that we're talking about this series being, well, a lot of like storylines with this series. 2019, Porzingis got traded to Dallas from New York, and for a while, the fan base hated him to the point that he got traded to Washington. And that's how the Celtics traded for him.
Do you know why they hated him?
Just they didn't like his style of play.
They didn't like his style.
They didn't like his style of play. And I mean,
I don't see why. I mean,
Luke,
if anything, he would have, to me, he would have helped Luka. And I don't know why. Luka is just amazing.
He's
they call it Luka Magic.
Luka, and he doesn't look like. He doesn't look like.
Somebody said he should looks like he's in a beer league.
Yeah, an athlete.
He just doesn't look like.
He just doesn't
like
look him. But then his shots aren't pure. I mean, it would be like me taking free throws and his
but
shots.
But he
makes them.
He does.
The guy's unbelievable. He throws his weight around.
He does.
He's a big boy.
He does, but he doesn't look like in a fast game that he
no.
can get up and down the court.
No.
He gets red in the face. You could see it. You know.
Yeah, and I think I think that's where the Celtics defense can shine because he is slow, so that they can they can press him more than somebody else who's quicker.
Yeah, he's not used to that fast pace.
Exactly, he's not used to that.
It's the same way when he was playing for I think it was Real Madrid before he got drafted. I think it was 2016-17.
Yeah.
Before he entered the draft, he was playing.
I don't think he's used to that.
He's not used to that fast
with that
pace.
Intensity.
No, and I think the Celtics got actually playing Indiana definitely helped them.
It did.
Because, you had to go up and down the. There's no other team that like runs up the gum. They look like, what's that cartoon? Roadrunner.
Roadrunner.
Unbelievable.
I'm not that old, Mike. I don't remember. Maybe in a history book I saw that or something.
Roadrunner. I don't know where that came from. That guy just
so let's move on a little bit. What do you think? Celtics in 4, 5, 6, 7?
I think I'm looking for the Celtics to sweep until they prove me different. You know, I think they're going to win. I will be surprised if Dallas wins tomorrow night. I really will. I mean, they should because they're home. And they have the home crowd, but Celtics are undefeated on the road in the playoffs.
Where I was going to go.
Think that the Celtics. Yeah, two losses were home game twos.
Because the Celtics, I think.
They're not fazed.
Want to win at home.
Yeah.
I think they would want to win at home. So if they'll sweep on the road. Obviously, they'll sweep it if they can.
Right.
Yeah. But I wouldn't be surprised if
I don't think they're going to let up.
They're not going to give it away.
They're not going to let up.
You know, if they get beaten, that's one thing, but I don't think they're going to give it away.
No, they're going
to have the Celtics, given their choice, would prefer to win at home in front of the fans.
Yeah, well, I don't think whatever it takes to get the four wins.
Absolutely. You know, you don't.
I don't think they're going
to take. Yeah, Dallas needs to take one of these.
You think they're going to take one?
No, I said they need to take one.
Oh, they do.
So this I will say, if the Celtics sweep the next episode of this, I'm bringing a Brumman.
You're bringing a Brumman?
Yes, I'm bringing a Brumman if they sweep.
And then we're going to make a replica of a duck boat riding around the studio.
Yeah.
All right.
I'll bring a pan so you can clean it up afterwards. Yeah.
You know, I think, you know, let's take a couple of minutes and
What do you think?
Talk about, as you would say, I'm stealing your line.
The mid-socks.
The mid-socks, because that's about where they are. They play the middle.
Mid.
You know, and you know, I'm the baseball guy. You have to give them credit for all the injuries and everything that's happened to them. You know, they could be 20 games behind if it wasn't for their pitching.
Well, you know what my friend says, and you could go on from this, but he says they're a minor league team. They look like a minor league team.
He's not far from the truth on that because they're bringing everybody up from the minors. But the guys who they're bringing up, they're contributing. You know, they're all kind of pitching in here and there, but, you know.
It's back and forth, though, man.
You know, I wouldn't want to be a bookie, man. I wouldn't want to be a bookie and have to set the line with them because you just never know. And
yeah, it's like two different teams at days. Either they're world beaters or, as your friend said, AAA team.
There's no middle ground with them. They're either going to beat you or they're going to stink.
So the Phillies are coming into Boston now.
That's not a good sign.
They're like the number one team in the National League.
Yeah, mine is JT Realmuto. Realmuto, it just actually announced before we started filming, out at least 8 weeks, he had to get knee surgery.
Is that the phone call you took in the hallway? No. It was from his medical team in Philly. You went on that?
Yeah, that's the catcher for them.
He's a catcher.
Well, we got Verdugo coming back.
Oh, God.
Verdugo
in a Yankees uniform still feels weird.
You know, Verdugo. Well, who else has come back? Who's coming? Somebody on the Phillies?
He made a comment,
too. Because Verdugo's going
to
come back.
Phillies, trying to...
Bryce Harper?
Harper, he wasn't on the Sox, though.
No, I'm trying to think of who's on the Sox who was coming back.
I remember that were on the Sox for a little bit were, I think it's just Schwarber and Matt Strom.
Yeah. How's Schwarber doing this year?
Typical Schwarber things. He'll be batting under 200, but whenever he gets contact with a ball, that's
30 home runs, 100 RBI.
He'll finish under the Mendoza line, but he'll have over 30 home runs.
Yeah. So
their pitching must be awesome this year for Philly, though.
Guys in that rotation. They re-signed Nola in the offseason. It looked like he was going to be gone, but they re-signed him. They extended Zach Wheeler, which that's done a lot for them. And also, Ranger Suarez is having a good year for them, too. That's normally their third, fourth guy in the rotation. Mm-hmm. He has an ERA under 2. I think he's up there top 3 in the NL for ERA.
Wow.
You know what? I like Rafaela on the Red Sox, but he has some good games, and then he has games when he does nothing.
Yeah, he shows up.
And he's still hitting around 200, right?
Yeah, he's not hitting well.
Yeah, there's one game he had, 7-8 RBIs?
Right.
Duran's having a great year for them.
Yeah, Duran is.
Now, where are they? I mean, what happened to Casas? Is he out for the year or what? What's going on with him? I haven't heard his name. And you know,
What did he have, shoulder surgery?
Yeah, he got shoulder surgery.
Is he out for the year or what?
I can look. I don't know if he is. I know Story's out for the year.
Story's out for the year. What a surprise.
Yeah.
I know.
Also, another thing, too. I saw this was a similar injury. I think
The pitcher.
Yeah, Bogaerts might be out for the year, too, for the Padres.
I heard that, yeah.
Oh, wow. Really?
Yeah.
But I heard, you know, the Sox are what? They're maybe what, 7 games out, 8 games out, right around there somewhere?
They're in third place.
Yeah, they're in there, but I
can't. Rib injury. He's setting his return for June 21st.
That's good next week. So, yeah. I mean, I look at some of the national, the pundits out there and, you know, potential who the Red Sox are going to trade and what they need to do. And it's like, I saw something, I think it was yesterday, that they wanted to send Pivetta. They wanted to get rid of Pivetta.
Pivetta and Jansen, probably.
And
Kenby Jansen.
Jansen and who's the hitter?
Not Devers.
No,
not Devers. He has a no-trade clause.
The kid who's hitting the home runs, O'Neill. Is it O'Neill?
O'Neill, yeah.
And they want to get rid of O'Neill. It's like, why?
Yeah, I know Jansen's expiring after this year.
He's on the injury list too now, O'Neal.
Yeah, Jansen's expiring after this year. I think O'Neal's expiring after this year too.
That's what they're saying, O'Neal.
And Pivetta also.
But Pivetta, he looked like a magician the last time he pitched.
Ooh, this thing.
You know, when he came back, he was a little slow returning off the IL. But Pivetta's hot and cold too. You never know what you're going to get with him.
Yeah, also, you were mentioning how the Sox are doing or wondering how they're doing. So, division-wise, they're 13 games out. They're 13 out, and wildcard-wise, they're 2 games out. They're 2 games behind Minnesota for the last wildcard.
Wow. And how'd they do against Minnesota?
Yeah. I think they won last night because the White Sox blew it. But again, it's the White Sox, and they've had a miserable couple seasons.
The Sox lose those games to the White Sox is beyond me. It's just like...
I know they split with them. Isn't that something?
Yeah.
And they will win 14 games or something?
And they can't win at home. I mean, we started off the season by saying if they play 500 at home, they're going to be a playoff team. And they're not. They're winning on the road more than they're winning at home. And it's killing them.
Yeah. Yeah. Normally how I am with this is people saying, oh, teams are doing well this early or not well this early. I'm like, normally around June, you could tell how a team's doing. The Red Sox are going to be mediocre the rest of the season.
Yeah, but who do they want to trade?
68, 69 games or something like that.
Yeah, something like that. 66. But who do they want to trade those guys for?
That's what they were saying, for prospects.
Yeah, for prospects, because all three of them are expiring. And I think Chris Martin's expiring, too. So that could be another guy.
Oh, they're going to go plunging right to the basement after that. That's just.
Is Devers living up to his contract extension? I don't think so.
He's hitting like 270 or something.
Yeah, you know, he's not hitting the home runs like he used.
He's not hitting the home runs.
He has nobody around him to drive in or nobody.
Yeah, the Red Sox are not an attractive free agent market anymore. They haven't been the last 5 years.
I don't think Cora is going to make it to the end of the year. They're going to find a scapegoat. And it's going to be him.
I won't be surprised if they fire him by the end of the season.
No.
Even before that. I'll say the earliest will be after the trade deadline.
And what the hell is Breslow doing? We talked about this before.
this is the recurring thing.
What is Breslow doing?
I don't know.
They bring this guy in. You know, he spouts off all of this wisdom. And then what's he doing?
He's a mouthpiece.
What value
mouthpiece
add does
for
he
Fenway.
Have?
He's a mouthpiece for John Henry. That's it.
Yeah, mouthpiece for Fenway. Like Kyle Dubas is the same with the Penguins.
Yeah.
The only good Fenway-owned team right now is RFK Racing. That is it.
In fact, I think John Henry was asked in an interview if he would sell the team, and he said no.
No, that's his cash cow. Why would he sell the Red Sox?
I know. It's just horrible. I mean, he puts, people going in the seats. Maybe they won't if they actually tumble to the basement.
I think what keeps them going is because Boston's a destination city.
That's right.
And they
get the tourists in here, and everybody comes, I have to go to Fenway.
I have
to see the monster.
Yeah, we talk about how mediocre this team is.
It's a destination city.
Yeah, we still go.
It's a destination
because
city.
Because it's New England. That's what Frank was saying.
Yes.
Frank and I looked that up earlier in the year, remember? We said that.
Yeah, attendance was up.
Attendance was up.
So Fenway thinks it's okay. It's like, okay, we're going to be mediocre, but still, we're getting attendance. Well, here's an idea to make Fenway and John Henry listen. And this, just hear me out. This might be a foreign concept. Don't go to games.
That's right. Don't go to games. Wear bags over your head if you go or something like they did.
I don't know if you watch the games. I don't watch all the games. I'll watch highlights and stuff. But how many times do you see when they pan the field? Everybody's on their phone.
Yeah.
Everybody's on their phone. They're playing with the phone. They're talking around. I mean, I don't think people are really interested in the game.
No,
they're there because they're at Fenway and they can get their picture taken.
That's right.
Look at me. I'm near the Green Monster. And, every once in a while, it's like, somebody hit a home run. Yay.
And it's normally for the other team.
Yeah, they don't, I don't think it's like back in the day when we used to go. I mean, I remember the game. I used to eat, drink, and sleep going to Fenway. And I was on every pitch.
I don't want to go.
And if I went with people who didn't know the game, what's that? What's that play? What's a bunt? I mean, they were very interested in the game. Now with the pink hats and the corporate seating, the corporate seats, they're like, oh, I'm going to buy, 100 box seats. And they give them out to their employees. And then they go and drink all night and have no clue about the
game. That's why regular Red Sox fans do not go to the game. They don't even talk about it on talk radio anymore. They don't mention the Red Sox at all. And they used to be like, that's all they talked about at this time of year. They're living on past glory. They're just
Past glory. Before I forget, Glenn Ordway's going into the Radio Hall of Fame in the next week or so.
Is he?
Glenn Ordway. Yeah, they pulled.
Well deserved.
They pulled in Glenn for the Hall of Fame. Yeah.
Well deserved.
Yeah. Yeah, it was interesting.
Yeah.
But anyway, I think we have just enough time maybe to talk
a little bit about the
Patriots. What do you think with Tom Brady going in? How do you think that's going to go between Belichick and Brady?
Yeah, Belichick's going to be there tomorrow.
He's going to be there.
I think it's going to be fine.
And you're going to be there.
I am going to be there.
Yeah, you so will
get the camera and the mic, man. We want live remotes, Mike. Yeah.
Oh, if I get a chance, I'll bring my phone and I'll take pictures. I'll try to bring it in. But
Remember, we went out there and we did our show from there when the Patriots won the Super Bowl?
Yeah.
Went to the Super Bowl?
That's right. Yeah.
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 We were right to. Gronk and Belichick off.
Yeah.
I have a picture of that. I have a picture of Gronk and Belichick and Brady.
What about back in the day? Oh, you want to go back that way? Let's go, we can go back.
We got a couple of minutes. We're all over the board.
Yeah.
What the hell?
Yeah.
So there was back in the day, we did the beards.
We did the beards. We were at Fenway Park.
We wore beards.
That's when we were number one. That's when we were
number
one.
We wore beards and we saw Jason.
Yeah, Jason Veritek, the biggest jerk.
Yeah, we tried to talk to him.
Biggest jerk was Jason Veritek. He come walking down the street like, hey, Jason, you got to go on live TV. Come on.
I know.
No, get out of there.
Screw, get out.
No, I think Brady's going to get a standing ovation tomorrow.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
And people are going to be like reliving the past. They'll have the Jumbotron.
The glory days.
You know, the glory days. Yeah, they'll probably play Bruce Springsteen.
And, where are you? I wonder if Bon Jovi's going to be there. Where are you sitting? Are you going to be down the field? Do you have any idea how this is going to work, Mikey?
I'm sitting low, but I'm not sure how close.
I have no idea how it's going to be set up.
I don't know either. But they're going to have, like, special guests. They're going to have music, supposedly, musical guests.
Yeah.
A lot of them. A hundred of his teammates are going to be there.
If you see Tom, ask him if he wants to come on the show.
Okay.
See if you can get Brady on it.
Yeah. Well, at the same time, if
or
he
anybody
was here,
that knows Tom,
there's nowhere to go but down once he appears here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's true. Well, we're running out of time. Believe it
or not. Yeah. Just one more thing before we go off, and I think Frank will second this. Happy early birthday, Mikey.
Happy birthday, Mikey.
That's right. Thank you.
Happy birthday, Mikey. 6:12.
So perfect opportunity.
Yeah. Tomorrow.
And we have a special guest in studio. We have our good friend, George Carr.
Yeah, we have our great audience here.
You know, Georgie Carr is sitting over here supporting
us. So we want to thank Luke and Chris in the booth for making us, as Frank said, look pretty.
Make us sound good.
I don't know about that. But anyway, until next time, Mike Wigdor.
TJ Chamberlain.
Frank Walsh. We will see you
down the road.